online service. It's been told recordings in progress. That's wonderful. Welcome to our online service at Mount Pleasant Baptist Church. Hope you're nice and comfortable in your home with a cup of tea or a cup of coffee. And we come together and worship the Lord. We look forward to what we're going to hear from Mark a little bit later. But all that we say and what we will sing, may it be a blessing to our hearts and give glory to the Lord. Well, to get us in the frame of worship, we're going to begin with a hymn that will lift our spirits, I think, get us in that mode. We're going to sing Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart. Thank you, Karen. Let us pray. Father God, we give thanks to you and come to you this day. We offer our hearts and our lives into your hands. We ask you, Lord, to speak to us and refresh our souls as we gather together in community, whether online or in person. We thank you that that experience enriches our hearts and our lives. We come to you, Lord, asking you to forgive us for the times we've gone our own way or gone against you, but we rejoice in the fact that all the time we can just turn back and come to you, and you meet us where we are. Meet with us today, dear Lord. come to us as we come to you. For we offer this service in Jesus' name. Amen. Just some words of the psalm. It's a lovely psalm. Psalm 121. If you'd like to just listen. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen. It's wonderful, I think, to be reminded of those words, whether night or by day, wherever we go, the Lord watches over us. He is always on our side. He always sustains us and has us in the palm of his hands, and we can always rejoice in that truth. Well, we're going to sing again. We're going to sing Meekness and Majesty. Again, a wonderful hymn reminding us of God's power and who he is and what he has done for us. So thank you, Karen. Thank you. Would you like to tell us, Mark, what's going on these next few days?
Let's unmute myself. A little bit of news and information stuff that you'll probably know about. So the regular stuff, you're always invited to Tuesday coffee break. If you're able to join the gathering that meet online Tuesday morning, I did so. I joined them last week. I think they were a bit shocked that I turned up, but hey, there you go. It's available for anybody. Anybody can drop in. So that's Tuesday morning. Thursday is normally our regular Bible study, and I do recordings of those afterwards, and so you can check those out if you're not able to join me on a Thursday evening. We have people coming from other churches as well to join us, which is lovely. Now, that's not happening this coming Thursday for a particular reason that I'm hoping church members will already know about. So some of you will recall that the Reverend Andy Baker came and preached for us a few weeks ago, the beginning of the year. And Andy is coming back next Sunday, so you can look forward to seeing Andy again. And prior to Sunday, there's an opportunity for folk, if you want to drop in and have a chat with Andy on the Thursday. That's Thursday afternoon or Thursday evening. And that's why I'm not leading the live Bible study Thursday evening, because I'll be here with Andy, and maybe one or two other people will be here as well. But what I'm going to do is make sure that there is a short, condensed, just 10 to 15 minute version of the online Bible study, so that we can keep the momentum going as we study the book of 1 Corinthians. So I'll make sure the message gets out regarding that. And then the following Thursday, so that's the 24th, if my maths is right, are we still in February? Yeah, I think we're still in February, aren't we? So the 24th of February. So we're going to call a special church. We have called a special church meeting for church members. And if you're a church member, I hope that you know about that now. And that's an opportunity for us to contemplate our future and consider various options. So I hope that you're aware of the church meeting on the 24th. Andy coming next Sunday. Hope you'll be able to make that to one of the services and an opportunity to meet Andy next Thursday before he comes on the Sunday. All nice and clear? Clear as mud, you say. Well, I wrote it all down, didn't I? And I hope that most of you have got that message. And if not, just ask somebody. Hey, you know, that's how we communicate, isn't it? You know, you're not sure about something, or something is unclear, or even worse than that, if you've jumped to a conclusion and you think something's happening, why don't you just check with somebody else and check that they've got the same conclusion? Because if they haven't, it might be that you've jumped to a wrong assumption. It's always best to communicate with one another, isn't it? So let's just keep the communication channels open so that we all know exactly what's happening and go from there. Anyway, I think that's all the sort of news and notices and information to share. So back to you, Dale.
Thank you, Mark. Let us take this opportunity now to come to the Lord in prayer, and I'm going to ask Graham to lead us. Thank you.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we've just sung of the meekness and majesty of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we come to you now, our Heavenly Father, we praise and worship you because you are God. You are God Almighty. And Lord, as we bow before you, we again just confess our sins, the sins which have exiled us from your presence. But we do praise you that in your great mercy and love for us, you've redeemed us through the blood of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus. And you've made us your children once again. And it's in the precious name of Jesus that we bow before you now, and that we're able to come to you with these prayers for our world, for our community, and for the church. And so, Lord, we pray for our world. And again, Lord, the headlines are full of fear and supposition around the country of Ukraine. And Lord, there's fear that that could ignite a conflict which no one can control. Lord, in your mercy, we pray that you would hold back the forces that would seek to engage with one another in war. And we pray for your peace, peace upon the people of Ukraine, peace, Lord, in the hearts and minds of those who maybe are more tempted to fight. Lord, in your mercy and in the power of your Holy Spirit, bring peace instead of war, we pray. And Lord, for all those other places where conflict has happened and has left such terrible consequences, we pray for those people, as the people in Afghanistan, Lord, who are suffering so much, that again you would be with them, that you would provide, that you would provide an answer, Father, to their sorrow and suffering. Lord, we pray for that government that is there now, the Taliban. That, Lord, we can only pray that in the power of your Holy Spirit, you would bring about change. Lord, there is so many governments in the world, including ours, that seem to have lost their way. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, bring clarity, bring right, bring compassion back into the heart of government, that people would not be just used, but would be able to thrive in doing what they do. And that you would be and have the glory, Lord, because it's only through you that we can pray these things. Lord, we pray for our community. Lord, we see people who are suffering, suffering because of illness, suffering because of the consequences of COVID in all its forms, suffering because of the rising prices of energy and food. Lord, we pray that in all the situations that our communities find themselves in, that you would provide, Lord, the sustenance, the direction, the encouragement that they need. And Lord, as we pray that, we recognize that the main way, maybe the only way that that can happen, is through your church, through your people in the community. And so, Lord, we do pray that your church would be salt and light effectively in the community where they are. Not just through the services, but just by being your people in the street, in the shops, in the workplaces. Lord, in your mercy, set your people, Lord, alight. And make them those living stones that can be seen and that can be channels for people to find you. Lord, we lift to you our community. We lift to you our church. We lift to you our world. Not because of anything that's in us, but because of you and your Holy Spirit, who can bring about these things that we pray for. And as, Lord, for your church, we would just remember especially those meetings that are coming up in the next couple of weeks. And we pray that, Lord, your people would discern your will through your Holy Spirit to your praise and to your glory. And for those, Lord, who need you in special ways, Lord, we can name people, but there will be others who we will forget to name or will not name. And Lord, there are those who maybe are keeping their sorrows and their pains to themselves. But Lord, you know. And so we lift to you those who need your special touch at this time. Be to them your comforter and their healer, we pray. And we bring all these things to you in the precious name of our Saviour and Lord, Jesus Christ, and in the power and fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Graham. Let's come to God's word once again, and invite Karen to give us our reading for this morning. Thank you.
So I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, through to chapter 2, verse 5. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom, as I proclaim to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Christ Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power.
Thank you, Karen. Well, before Mark gives us our message this morning, we're going to sing another hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Thank you.
Oh,
So, Lord, we pray for Mark as he gives us your word and speak through him and use him powerfully. May we have ears to hear, hearts to receive. So we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Mark.
Amen. And thank you, Dale. And I trust I'm unmuted and that you can all hear me and see me. Okay. Well, if you have a Bible and you followed Karen reading 1 Corinthians, open that up again now and keep your finger in it. That will be helpful for you this morning. Who'd have thought it? Now, there's a question that you can apply to all sorts of situations. Who'd have thought that Wales would beat England yesterday? Okay, well, every Welsh person thought they would, because we just expect Wales to beat everybody, don't we? Who'd have thought it? We can apply that to people. Who'd have thought that she would have filled in the gap? We can apply it to events. Who'd have thought that we'd still be in? You can apply it to events. And you can apply it to pub names as well. Did you know that? In fact, there were a number of pubs just north of Plymouth, and also some in Somerset and Kent, and they're actually called Who'd Have Thought It? You check it out. Don't Google it now, listen to me, but you check it out later, a whole series of pubs. Well, I think it can be applied to us today and to our message and to what the Apostle Paul would want to say to us through 1 Corinthians. It can certainly be applied to the Christian message, Who'd Have Thought It? Because there are so many aspects of the Christian faith that are something of a surprise. The great Christian hymn writer John Bell from Scotland writes a number of beautiful Christmas Christian hymns, including a Christmas one that goes like this. Who would think that what was needed to transform and save the earth might not be a plan or army, proud in purpose, proved in worth? And it goes on to talk about how amazing it is that actually what was needed was to go for God to come from heaven to earth. And it's a hymn that celebrates Christmas, Christ's first coming. Well, I want to apply this phrase, who'd have thought it, to the church. For I think it could easily be the Apostle Paul's reaction, both to the church today and certainly to what was going on in Corinth at the time. This is my message today, is part of a little mini series of things that I want us to remember, things to remember. And I think that there are some central, foundational, and important things that every vibrantly alive, every gifted and resourced church needs to remember. Well, the Corinthian church was vibrantly alive, gifted, and resourced, but they were in danger forgetting the very person who was responsible for their spiritual life. And I think the Apostle Paul might have reacted by saying, who'd have thought it? Who'd have thought that was possible, that they could forget Jesus? Their focus, you see, had shifted from Jesus to themselves. The spotlight was going from Jesus to other people. And the Apostle Paul wants to bring them, and I think wants to bring us, back to Jesus. For the same church was in danger of focusing not on who Christ was and what he had done for them, but on who people were and what they were doing for them. You see, the Corinthian church's problem was that they were impressed with impressive things that seemed powerful, appealing, attractive. Paul brings them back to Jesus, and in particular, the cross of Jesus. So that's what we get as a focus in verse 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. If you're sitting there this morning and you're thinking, oh, do you know what, Mark? If I'm totally honest with you, I was really hoping for something that would be more interesting than that today, something more imaginative, something more enticing today, because well, we're never going to forget about the cross of Jesus, are we? How could we forget about the cross of Jesus? We, you know, it's mentioned in all sorts of Christian services and contexts. Some of you wear a silver piece around your neck to remind you of the cross. We share bread and wine sometimes, don't we? Remember, it's always on the fourth Sunday of the month now. Try and remember that. And that reminds us of the cross. We're not going to forget the cross, Mark. Okay, well, if you want to reassure me that you're not going to, that's great. That's very comforting to me. But I think today I do just want to address this question because there is a danger that we can get bored by overfamiliarity. What do I mean by that? Well, repetition can be really annoying, can't it? You know, people just saying the same thing over and over again, you know, whether it's the conversations that they have or the prayers that they pray or the things that they do, it can just be really boring. But actually, repetition can be really helpful too. It's a way in which we can remember key things, learn key and important things. Well, I just suspect that we can occasionally get a little bit tired of the little we know about the cross of Jesus. But we will not get tired, I don't think, of the great depths of meaning and truth that are contained within the cross of Jesus. Okay, let me tell you this then. Have you ever looked out at the ocean? You've been standing on a beach, and wouldn't some of us like to be able to do that at the moment? You stand on a beach and you look out at the sea or the ocean, and it's mesmerizing for a little while. But you do it for long enough, and it's just more waves, isn't it? And it's just more water, and it's just more sea. And it just goes on and on and on, and it doesn't sort of change. Well, there was a line from a famous poem, a poem called The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, and it said, "Water, water everywhere, and not a drop to drink." So we can look at the ocean and actually get bored doing so. But then comes along David Attenborough with a documentary about oceans, and we are re-amazed by the vast body of water that's there in front of us. And we're awestruck by its length and its depth. And so it is with the cross of Jesus. We can get bored, but only if we're not stretched in our understanding and our amazement as to what it means and what it achieves. Because the Bible tells us of the love of Christ and that it is deeper and wider than any cursory or dismissive or bored glance that we might give it. Yeah, we do sometimes get bored with those things that are overfamiliar. May we never get bored with the cross of Jesus. We also, I think, drift from its central core to our thoughts and our being. I suspect that sometimes we're not unlike a boat that loses its navigation system and loses its location and forgets where it is and drifts from its intended course. I think that comes from our sinful DNA, that we drift from the cross. I don't know if any of you thinking about oceans know of the RNLI, the Royal National Lifeboat Institute. Well, occasionally they run fundraising events. They're a charity, like all charities, they need to raise funds, and some of the adverts that they put on television are quite emotional, seeing people scooped up from danger and helped to safety. I remember an advert, I think it was a year or two back, when they changed the words RNLI and they tripped them over and they spelled HELP, help, because they said, "And that's what we do. The RNLI help people." Unfortunately, it's not what we say, is it, so often? It's not what we shout out. It's not what we cry out. Because, well, we think we can manage ourselves. We think we can cope. We think we're okay. We think we can do things and sort things. And I think deep within our heart, there is a dislike for calling for help, even saving help from God. And if it's true of Christians, as I think it is, it's true of all, that there is still sin within our hearts and in our habits And so this message this morning from 1 Corinthians, primarily verse 18 of this first chapter, I think is important for us. Because in this one sentence, I think we have one of the truly great moments of the Apostle Paul's writing. Because he says, to the perishing, the cross of Jesus looks foolish, utterly balmy, pointless. To those who are saved, it will look, well, he doesn't say wise and he doesn't say brilliant. He says powerful. Well, I hope as a church, of all the things that we could be about, of all the things that we ought not forget, that we would never tire of the foundational and central, essential and wonderful message of the cross of Christ. The Corinthian church, well, they were losing their grip on this, to be honest, as seen in the way that they were behaving towards one another. They were not necessarily treating one another right. They regarded some of them regarded themselves as superior in contrast to the inferior ones. Some of them regarded themselves as mature in contrast to the immature ones. Well, how they spoke of each other, how they spoke to each other, how they regarded one another, almost demonstrated that they were losing their grip and not realizing the difference that the gospel of Jesus makes to every aspect of life. And if you think the idea of forgetting about the cross, or if you think the idea of losing focus and appreciation of the significance of the cross is almost unbelievable for us, well, at least acknowledge that lots of people have lots of ideas as about what the church is supposed to be for, what we're supposed to be doing. Ask any group of people, undertake a survey down on the high street, or conduct a Mori poll, if you like. And people will say the church is for doing good causes, charity and helping the needy. Or the church is for personal morality, you know, behavior and responsibility. Or the church is for pious activities like singing and praying. All of those things are perfectly fine. But none of them are saying that the role and responsibility of the church is to announce what Christ has done and to participate in the work that he's doing by the enabling of his Spirit. And so to make sure that we're not being sucked into the ways and means of society and their thinking, we need to appreciate what the Apostle Paul is saying in this passage. So just a couple of simple points, really. There is a deep tendency within ourselves to focus on ourselves. The Corinthians appear to want something that was more impressive than the cross of Christ. And perhaps that's understandable, especially if we imagine what many people are hearing when we talk about the cross of Jesus. Are they simply hearing us being excited about a dead hero? Well, if that's what they're hearing, they could well be underimpressed, unimpressed, and think it was all foolish talk. Yet with brutal brevity, I nicked that from somebody else, with brutal brevity, I think what Paul shows in these verses is how the cross divides people. He shows the contrast between those who regard the cross as foolish and those who regard the cross as the power of God. And when we speak of such stark divisions, the contrast between those who are perishing and those who are being saved, it can feel as if we're perpetuating a polarizing impact. Polarization, it happens all around us, doesn't it? People talk of progressives and conservatives, pro-life or pro-choice, tolerant or intolerant, ancient or modern, Generation X or Generation Has-Beens. Paul doesn't talk about this contrast between the perishing and those who are being saved lightly. But it is an explanation of reality. For it's in people's reaction to the cross that God reveals those who are perishing and those who are being saved. That's what he says. The cross is powerful. We might have thought that Paul would say the cross in contrast to the foolishness of how some people see it, that the cross would be wise or impressive. But no, he says, the contrast between foolishness is God's power. We're not just discussing whether the cross is a beautiful painting to be admired in an art gallery, or whether to be recoiled from a brutal item of torture. We're not talking about whether we like it or not. What we're considering here is the very defining act of salvation. The cross of Jesus is the way God keeps people from perishing. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. I think it's entirely understandable that some people don't like this, that some people resist this, that some people think it's foolish speak, because sometimes we prefer to be our own saviors. We prefer to be able to do things for ourselves without recourse from help from others. Our independent spirit, I think, is the epitome of our rejection of God and our resistance to a savior. But to say that is deeply countercultural, because the cross is deeply countercultural in the sense that it seems so unimpressive. Many people were impressed with Jesus' teaching, but many more wanted him to perform miracles rather than just teach. And he did perform many miracles, but not at the request of those who demanded them. And this pressure to impress comes upon the church sometimes too. It's commonplace today to value education, wisdom, wealth, and especially power. And time and again, churches end up valuing these things because that is what we members value in our day-to-day lives. I wonder, and fear sometimes, how many people have been appointed to roles of church leadership on the basis of their position in society or their wealth in the community. I pray God it hasn't happened amongst us. But churches will sometimes talk about the power of God, but look for miracles and signs and wonders, and forget that the power of God is the cross of Christ. Which is why great speaking skills, brilliant oratory, terrific rhetorical abilities, although it impresses some, sometimes we see it in politicians, although less so today. Sometimes we see it among scientists when we follow the science, and we don't always do that, do we? Sometimes we're impressed by entertainers, trendsetters, and influencers, although frankly, who knows why? I think it just shows how shallow we are sometimes. It's elsewhere that the power of God lies. The power of God lies in the work of Christ, Christ on the cross. It's not through the wisdom of the world that we come to know God. Have any of the isms brought people to God? Capitalism, communism, humanism, hedonism. They all dismiss or disregard the most astonishing act of divine self-disclosure, the cross of Christ. Not only do they not point the way to God, they offer ways that don't get to God. Long ago, and it's clear in verse 19 of our passage, God would bypass the ladder of wisdom and strength, and he would save people through the message of Christ crucified. We've got a poster board outside the church here, and I've no doubt you know of many churches that have notice boards or billboards or poster boards or whatever, and they put up phrases and captions and verses sometimes, and some of them are desperately cringeworthy and very embarrassing, and I wouldn't want to be connected with them at all, and others are really quite clever and punchy, and this was one that I heard of, almost tempted to adopt for us. But I think this one is great. God built a bridge between heaven and earth using two planks of wood and three nails. Who would think that what was needed to transform and save the earth might not be a plan or army proud in purpose proved in worth. Who would think, despite derision, that a child should lead the way? God surprises earth with heaven coming here on Christmas Day, or on any day, coming and giving his life for us. Yet there is a deep tendency for us to focus too much upon ourselves, but we need to focus on the divine power of God. One person looks at a crumpled piece of paper with some random numbers on it, and it looks like a piece of rubbish, and they throw it in the bin. Another person looks at that same piece of paper and realizes it's the combination to a safe, and it's crucial to acquire the treasure. Think of the message of the cross of Jesus as a small key that someone places in your hand. It's a cheap bit of metal, and you could get a duplicate down at Timpson's for £2. But this is the key that perhaps opens the prison that you're in and will one day open the palace down the road. It's the message of the gospel, the key that enables us to walk in fellowship with God, the key that opens the prison of death and will open the palace of glory. I realize that's a fairly weak and poor illustration, but it was the best one that I could come up with. And my attempt, really, to point out how important the cross is. With any understanding of what Jesus' death on the cross achieves, we will see that it is the key for life and love and forgiveness, for all our hopes and all our dreams. Just as Paul says in these verses in 1 Corinthians, God had long decided that no human brain or brawn would be able to reach him, but he would reach out to us. And through the life and death and resurrection of Jesus, he gives a key that will open the prison and one day the palace. So the cross of Christ, finally, needs to be the defining mark of our lives. You've been with people, probably, who you've comforted or encouraged, provided strength or support. I bet you have. You do it in conversations all the time. You do it through phone calls, through Zoom meetings, through meeting up with people over coffee or in their homes. Well, I have the privilege of doing these things too. And occasionally I will spend time with someone who is grieving. Occasionally I will spend time with someone who is dying. Occasionally I will spend time with someone who is frightened. And sometimes at the time, and sometimes only later because I'm a bit slow, I realize and I remember that the cross of Jesus is the best news that I can offer to any of those people in any of those situations. Because the cross says to the grieving person, there's forgiveness for mistakes and hope for the future. The cross says to the dying person, there's forgiveness for the past, there is fellowship in the present, and there's an eternal future. And the cross says to the frightened person, you're not on your own, you're greatly loved, and there is somebody who is with you and who will give you wisdom for the days ahead. From this, we can see that the cross is not preschool, nursery Christianity that somehow we grow out of or grow away from. It's not Jesus 101 that we can leave behind. The cross is all important and central to our faith and to our lives. It illuminates every struggle. It doesn't take away struggles, but it says to the person who is struggling, you're not on your own and things are not hopeless. You cannot be on your own because Christ died for you. And it's not hopeless because his death changes everything. The whole summary of these verses that Karen read can point out the weakness that the message sounds like, but it isn't weak. The weakness that the message that the members look like, but we're not weak, we're chosen. And the weakness of the messengers sometimes, people like me and others, we're not impressive. And yet God still chooses to use us, however unimpressive or inarticulate, broken and damaged that we are too. Because God chooses people. He chose Abraham and Sarah when they were old. He chose Gideon, even though his army was tiny. He chose David, even though he was the baby in the family. He chose the Apostle Paul, even though he was nothing special to listen to. And he works through the message of Good Friday, of Jesus's death on the cross, which looks like a tragedy, but is the power of God to save us. So, in simple terms, time to finish. Don't forget the centrality, the crux, the cruciality of the cross. Even though you've heard about it before, its meaning is deeper and wider and beyond our ultimate fathom, and therefore something worth continuing to ponder upon, because we cannot meet God safely if we are not forgiven. We cannot be forgiven other than through the cross of Christ. The cross is the key out of the prison and the key into the palace. These are things that we should remember. Let's pray. Our gracious God, we thank you for these wonderful truths, that you are the God who seeks us out and calls us to Christ, to come to belong to him. It's a huge privilege that we have. It's our identity. We belong to Christ. But that's only possible because of his death on the cross. And so we want to thank you for that. And we want to ask you to help us never to forget it. Lord, continue to work in our hearts and our minds as we continue to ponder upon and understand more of the extent of your love for us that comes through the death of Jesus. Would you equip us and bless us for the days ahead and help us to remember such things. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Mark, for those really important reminders. Thank you. Let's conclude our service with our final hymn, talking about what Mark has shared with us. It was finished upon the cross. Thank you. Well, thank you everyone for coming, and pray that the Lord has blessed you. Have a wonderful week. And let's share, if you'd like to unmute yourself, we'll have multiple voices as we say this, the words of the grace together. May the grace
of our Lord Jesus Christ,
the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
We have